In our study of the book of Romans, and this morning we're going to look at the verdict. As we have been mentioning, the book of Romans truly is a courtroom scene. Someone rightly called the book of Romans a forensic treatise. That is, there is these arguments, they're going back and forth. Of course, God Almighty, He lays out the specific charges against all of humanity. All of humanity is condemned because of sin. And so in the opening chapters, we have God laying out these charges. In chapter 2, we've already mentioned, we have man that begins to object. They begin to file their defense arguments, their defense pleas, and so forth. And now in chapter 3, we've seen some things regarding the problem with all of humanity. And of course, what is the ultimate problem with all the human race? Chapter 3, verse 10, as it is written, there is none righteous. How many? No, not one. All right. So the ultimate indictment is that no one in all of humanity, short of the Lord Jesus Christ, possesses the righteousness that God could ever accept. And so then there's a description, of course, of man's character and conduct and so on and so forth. So now we are going to hear the verdict. Romans chapter 3, verse 19. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty. There's the verdict. Okay, God allowed humanity to file their objections. All of the self-defense pleas have already been considered by the court. And God's listening. God's a patient God, isn't He? And by the way, does God have to stand there and listen to the lame excuses and arguments that mankind is filing? He doesn't have to do that, but does He? Go ahead, give me your best shot, as it were. And so after all of these arguments, the excusing one another, the accusing one another, all of the running away, and then ultimately blaming God for the problem of sin and so on and so forth, the final verdict is this: guilty as charged. And that's what verse 19 now is proclaiming. The official declaration of the courtroom of Almighty God is God finds humanity guilty as charged. Okay? Verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're going to examine the verdict. Verse 19 starts off, notice, now we what? Now we know. Now this is very important language in Paul's epistles. In fact, this is language which is very unique in God's word. Language like verse 19, now we know. Look at verse 21. But now, look at verse 26, to declare, I say, at this time. That language has everything to do with the dispensational nature of the book of Romans. And by the way, look at verse 21 again. You see the first, but now? That's a Paulism. You think, what in the world's a Paulism? When Paul uses those two words, but now, he's not using it to contrast two issues. He's not using it simply to contrast two different things. When Paul uses that language, but now, He uses it to emphasize the great dispensational significance, the great dispensational change that has occurred in human history. Do you know that that language, but now, is found in Paul's epistles at least 18 times in connection to what God is now doing today in human history? You know how often it's used before Paul's epistles? Zero. Now people say, wait a minute, you know, Paul's just an extension, Paul's just number 30. You know what? Just read. I'm not trying to demean or critical, but when Paul's the only one who is emphasizing now something's going on. Something today is happening that is different than the way things used to be. Absolutely critical to recognize the dispensational significance of that but now language. And here's another little tidbit. Prior to Paul, nobody uses that language but now in a dispensational sense. Paul uses it at minimum 18 times. I actually count 23 times. But you know how often that language is used after Paul's epistles? It's used twice in the book of Hebrews. But you go to the so-called general epistles, and you know, Christendom has labeled the books of Hebrews through Revelation as the, quote, general epistles. They're not general. They're Jewish epistles. And it's fascinating that James, John, Peter, and Jude never, not once, describe what they're teaching as part of the but now time period in human history. Isn't that interesting? A couple of years ago, there was a real trend. All of Christianity, the book of James was like a big deal. The book of James. We're going to look at some things about the, quote, book of James. James never writes, oh, you know what, audience, but now. No, James doesn't write that. Paul's the only one in the New Testament. Now, doesn't that mean something? It does mean something. It certainly indicates something extremely important. So going back to verse 19, let's now kind of go through the passage a little bit. Verse 19, now we know. Prior to Paul, nobody can say what verses 19 and following is going to describe. Nobody did. Paul is extremely significant. Not that he was significant in his person and being. I mean, Paul says, I'm the chief of sinners. Paul says, I'm not worthy. But like Paul says, I magnify mine office. Guess who magnified his office before Paul did? The Lord Jesus Christ magnified his office, okay? Verse 19, now we know. What do we know now? That what things soever the law saith. What's, you know what? We sometimes think in generalities, right? Whatsoever the law saith. Let's go back to the law for just a second. Exodus chapter 20. Let's go to the law for a second here. And wait a minute. Okay, Paul. Well, what does the law say? Exodus chapter 20. Look at Exodus chapter 20, verse 1. Exodus 20, verse 1. And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God. Who is the Lord talking to, by the way? I mean, he's talking directly to Moses, but who is God ultimately talking to? When he says, I'm your God, he's talking about that Israel. Remember, I mean, we won't go back there. Chapter 19, verse 1. Well, I guess we are going back there. Chapter 19, verse 1. In the third month, when the children of who? Israel, Israel, Israel. And what does God have to say about Israel? Look at verse 5. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye, who's the ye? Israel shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. Guess where everybody else is? They're second-class citizens. For all the earth is mine. Verse 6, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of who? Israel. So what does God do with this holy nation, this distinct group of people that enjoy this identity before Jehovah God? Chapter 20, verse 1, and God spoke all these things, all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee, Israel, out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Now let's get to the nitty-gritty here. Verse 3, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Verse 5, thou shalt not bow down thyself. Verse 7, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Verse 8, remember the Sabbath day. Keep it holy. Verse 12, honor thy father and thy mother. Verse 13, thou shalt not kill. Verse 14, thou shalt not commit adultery. Verse 15, thou shalt not steal. Verse 16, thou shalt not bear false witness. Verse 17, thou shalt not covet. Now, these are just the first 10. Are things going to get easier for Israel here? Thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. And then God, he adds another listing, but thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt. What does Paul say now about this system that God himself devised and established and entrusted to his distinct people Israel? What do we now know about all of this information? Go back to Romans chapter 3, verse 19. And I'm not the one saying it. This is Jesus Christ who's saying it through the pen of the apostle of the Gentiles. What do we know about all of the thou shalt nots and all of the thou shalts? Romans 3:19. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law. Why? That every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Wait a minute. Aren't the Ten Commandments good? Are the Ten Commandments important? What do we now know about all that information? We now know it keeps your mouth shut. You have no legitimate claim. You have no legitimate argument. You know what we now know? You know what that whole system did? It proves you're guilty. Whoa! Who before Paul ever studied the law and said, hey, Israel, or anybody else, we're guilty? What does religion, you know what the self-righteous moralist does? They look at that listing, and you know what those moralists did? They weren't content with 10. By the way, God gave over 600. I mean, you count them. I'm not anywhere from 600 to 800. And you know what Israel said? We're not content with just 800 specific laws. We're going to pile on a few more. You see, the self-righteous moralist, he dares to think, I can do it. Paul now says, we know something about that. Not only does it pronounce guilt. Look there at verse 20. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is, what do we now know about that law program? Is the knowledge of sin. Who before Paul ever said that? Whoever proclaimed before the Apostle Paul that that whole system that God gave to the nation of Israel was for the sole purpose of exposing sin? Nobody. Somebody, here. I read an article written by a theologian who is no friend of dispensationalism, but you know he actually made a distinction between what he calls Pauline Christianity and Jewish Christianity. You can reject the principle of right division, but if you honestly read your Bible, you have to go away admitting what Paul says is a complete deviation, a radical deviation from everything that has been written before him. Jesus never said, yeah, look at that law and understand, Israel, you're found guilty, and understand, Israel, that now we know something about sin. Did Jesus ever say that? You know what the Lord Jesus said? Jesus says, I'm going to tell you something about the law. Number one, not one jot or tittle is going to pass from it. And if anybody teaches likewise, they're going to be least in the kingdom. And I'm going to tell you something. You've heard it said of old, thou shalt not kill. And what did Jesus say? But I'm going to say this to you. If you're angry with your brother against the without a cause, you're guilty. Jesus said, thou heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I'm going to tell you something, Israel. You look upon a woman lustfully, that little straying gaze, you've committed adultery in your heart. Jesus never said, there's the knowledge of sin. In fact, Paul, we're going to say something about antinomianism. There is in theology a label, antinomianism, that is used to discredit us. And let me, who's the first antinomial, if I can call him antinomial? Look there at verse 21. But now the righteousness of God without the what? That's what antinomianism. Nomianism is all about. Antinomial, nomos, law. Anti, without, against law. So you know what some in theology will do to us who claim that we're not under law. They call us lawless. There is in the Bible the word lawless. So they say, you Protestants or you grace believers, that you are lawless. Now, wait a minute. What did we just read there in verse 21? But now the righteousness of God with anti the what? Law. Nomos. The Greek word nomos. Anti-law. We're not lawless, but we are without it. And that's because the verse is teaching it, okay? We'll say a few more things about that, all right, in just a second. Going back to verse 19. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law. Now understand, what Paul is doing is, Paul is demonstrating that the Jew is doubly convicted. Now remember the whole argument here. What is the Jew trying to do here? Go back to chapter 2, verse 17. Chapter 2, verse 17. Behold, thou art called a Jew, and resteth in the law, and maketh thy boast of God, and knoweth his will, right? And approveth the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law. So what is the Jew doing? The Jew is hiding behind the law. The Jew is using the law as though it is to their benefit. But you know what we now know? It's not for your benefit. The law will destroy you. And now you ought to understand why Paul, why is Paul still bringing up this issue of the law? Chapter 3, verse 1, what advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? So you see, the argument is, hey, listen, as a Jew, I possess immunity. But you know what Paul is communicating here? Number one, you're guilty because you're sinners. But secondly, you know you're guilty because you're transgressors of the law. Double conviction. Now, think about that. That's what Paul's doing in chapter 3, verse 19. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them that are under the law. That's Israel. And you know why Paul has to say that? Because Israel, you're proven to be transgressors of that very system. We now know something about that law. That law system will kill you, and it cannot give to you personal righteousness that allows you to stand before a just and holy God. That law can't change you in the inner man. Israel, you don't understand. That law is not a means of access to Almighty God. The law is a one-way ticket to hell. So Paul's, he's a wonderful prosecutor, isn't he? Listen, you're not only are you sinners, the very vehicle you think will give you immunity, you violated it. And if you violate one point of the law, God says you're guilty of them all. You've heard of the expression, throw the book at them. Well, listen, you violate one law, God says throw the whole thing at them. You violated the whole system. You violated the entire spirit. Verse 19, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it does say to them that are to the nation of Israel. And so because the law condemns Israel, that every mouth may be stopped. This is wonderful. God in his genius, and we're going to understand in his mercy and grace, stop it. Stop it. Why do you persist in defending your actions? Go to Job chapter 9. Here's a great little picture here. You know what our problem is, right? You know what our problem is. I didn't do it. You can't prove it. It's not my fault. Remember what Paul says by when he says that every mouth may be stopped. What do we know about the mouth already in the book of Romans? Accusing or excusing or blame. You see, and man, we are great at yakking. And we defend ourselves. Self-justification. Stop. And the Lord, stop it. Shut your yap. Okay, shut it. Shut it. And then we still want to blurb. One more little word. Shh. And you know what it is about human nature? We always want to throw in that but you don't understand. God's saying, stop it. Job chapter 9. Let me get over there real quick. Job chapter 9, verse 1. Job 9, verse 1. Then Job answered and said, I know it is so of a truth, but how should man be just with God? If he will contend with him, he cannot answer him one of a thousand. You know what he's saying, right? By the way, look at verse 2. I know it is so of a truth. How should man be just with God? By the way, the revelation that was entrusted to the Apostle Paul provides the final solution, the final answer to that question. How can a sinner, guilty, be just? Paul's going to tell us how, by the way. But I love verse 3 there. If he, a man, contend with him, God, he cannot answer him one. What do you have to say before God? And you know, there are so many, just drop down to verse 20. There are word pictures in Scripture that describe, listen, you might be a blowhard now, and I don't mean to be unkind when I say that. You may talk big now, but you know what the Scriptures say? When you stand before a holy God, you're going to be silent. What can you say? Not one word. In verse 20 here, if I justify myself, mine own mouth shall condemn me. You know, that's an interesting picture, the great white throne judgment. You know, why is there a great white throne judgment? You know what the sinner's going to do? The sinner's going to condemn himself. Look at the end of verse 20. If I say I am perfect, it shall also prove me what? Perverse. Verse 32, for he is not, talking about, he is not a man as I am, that I should answer him and we should come together. And see, wait a minute, who am I to answer him? Speechless. You know what God is looking for? That soft, repentant heart that basically says, I have no defense. You see, God, that's the honest heart, right? And God, by the way, he responds to that honest heart. But I know what the sin nature is all about. We are always trying. There was some infidel in France, well-known French politician who sired numerous children, never got married. He's just bedhopper. And some bishop or whatever, you know, kind of said, you know, you're going to answer for that. You know, in the afterlife, I guess he was saying. And this vile, disgusting politician, oxymoron, I'm sorry, I shouldn't say, he says, well, when I have my day, I'll answer, I'll defend myself against God. You see that arrogant? Don't worry. When I have my day, I'll defend myself against him. You got nothing to say? And that's why God's looking for that softness that comes to this stark realization, I ain't got one legitimate excuse. Go back to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. So verse 19, God says, stop it, shut up, you're guilty. But we have to keep reading. Verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, and we just saw some of that, but have you ever killed anybody? No, I've never killed. Have I ever committed adultery? No. I mean, go through. And yet, verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Well, then, what was the purpose of the law? See, those who accuse us of antinomianism, they just can't let loose of that law. They think that there is some sort of value, there is some sort of benefit in the law. Thou shalt not. And what Paul is now revealing by revelation from the Lord Jesus Christ is that the deeds of the law can never justify a human being. Now, if you are a self-righteous moralist, that's tragic. Because what does the self-righteous moralist believe? Well, if I live up to it, I can attain. But wait a minute. Praise God. He's not going to justify anybody by the deeds of the law. Is that bad news or good news? It depends on what side of the room you're in. If you're going to be like that Pharisee, you know, that Pharisee who prides himself, or even that little old lady who possesses as much pride, who thinks, I've lived a good life. For this Paul to come around and say, guess what? God's not going to justify it because of all of that. Her whole world's going to fall apart. Well, then what have I been doing all my life? I've been living right. I've been trying hard. You see, the self-righteous person, that's absolute travesty. But for the one who is honest and admits, I can't do it. Hey, this is good news. The means of justification, the means of acceptance is not dependent upon, it never hinges upon my performance. Isn't that good news? You see what God's trying to do here? Shut up and let me tell you something here. Because it's going to get real good here in a second, all right? Because the righteousness that God demands is provided for by God himself. Thank you, Lord. Think about here. Don't think of God as some cruel entity sitting out there enjoying, condemning, and finding. God says, yes, my holiness and my integrity demands this absolute perfect righteousness. But God's good news is, I'll provide it for you. Because we can't do it. That's love. That's mercy. That's what grace is all about. So if you value your own human righteousness, and you want to go back to that law system, which is nothing more than a dispensation of human righteousness. Think about it. The law is a sin management system. You want to live your life trying to control and trying to alter. You want to live under a performance system, and that's what the law is. It's a performance management system. God is saying, forget it. It won't work. Never did, and it never will. This is good news. Go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Man, it's almost as though God's trying to tell us that that whole pool of filthy, guilty, condemned sinners, he's trying to say, I want you to relax. God says, I'm at peace with you, and I want you to enjoy that peace with me. No more toiling, no more striving, no more trying, no more seeking, no more doing your best. God's saying, just believe me and rest in what it is I want to give you. Galatians chapter 3, verse 21. Galatians 3:21. Is there a law then against the promises of God. God forbid. For if there had been a law, I love this, not laws, plural. If there had been one law, if there had been just one law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But you know what we're finding out? Not one law, not one law could give life. Then why did God do it? I mean, we can go right back to the creation. God gave one rule. Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Is that so complicated? Is that complicated? I mean, he's not asking God, don't eat of all the abundant fruitful trees that are all over this garden. You see, the one, and by the way, it's a special tree. We understand that. You see, and by the way, they knew what that tree was. They knew where that tree was, and they knew what the consequences were. Okay, God didn't trick anybody. He says, that's the one. Don't eat. How simple. By the way, don't eat, thou shalt not. You see the whole spirit of the law, thou shalt not, thou shalt. Don't do it, don't eat it, don't touch. You know, well, Satan said don't touch it. They both ate from it. They both ate from it. So what Paul is saying is, if there was a law that could give you life, then guess how righteousness would be earned? By the law. And the whole point that Paul is ultimately making here is, there is no law that could give life. Not one of those laws could give eternal life. Well then, why the law? Go back to Romans chapter 3. Listen, I don't believe we're, quote, without law just simply because I don't like the law. Okay? You know, call me an antinomial. I don't care, whatever you want to call me. But let's find out what our apostle has to say about the law. We've already read Romans 3, verse 20, right? Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of what? Sin. Verse 28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Chapter 4, verse 13. Chapter 4, verse 13. For the promise that he, Abraham, should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the what? Through the law. Verse 14. For if they which are of the law be heirs, that is, if they become heirs by virtue of their own human achievement, faith is made what? Void. And the promise made of none effect. But Paul seems to be a little bit antinomian, isn't he? Isn't he a little lawless? Doesn't he seem to have an attitude against the law? Does he sound like he's for it? Does Paul ever say, thank God there is such a thing as the law? Because it's useful. And by the way, Paul's not going to say it isn't useful unto salvation, but it's useful for our practical day-to-day sanctification. Perish the thought. If the law couldn't give you life, the law can't produce functional life. There is life that has to do with our eternal standing and state before Almighty God. That is an eternal life, but then there is functional life. And you know what? The law can't help us in either realm. Paul has a lot of negative things. I'm not saying it. Look at what Paul says about it, right? Verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham. When we get to chapter 4, we're going to see how Paul continually emphasizes the issue of faith. Chapter 5, look at chapter 5, verse 20. Moreover, the law entered, why? That the offense might be eradicated? Can the law take care of the offense? Listen, the law, moreover, the law entered that the intent, the purpose, the offense might, what? Abound? You know what the law does? It fleshes out what's already inside of you. Please understand that. The law simply reveals what you are made of. Chapter 6, verse 14. The most antinomian verse in Paul's epistles. Chapter 6, verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law. What's the converse? Well, then how can sin have dominion over you? Live under the law. Wow. Chapter 7, verse 4. Chapter 7, verse 5. For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the what? By the law. Man, this sounds pretty bad. Verse 13. Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become what? Exceeding sinful. The purpose of the law is to make sin appear. An MRI. Any of you ever gone through an MRI? I've been through an MRI. And, you know, the law is like an MRI. What does the MRI do? Listen, I can come in, you know, the picture of health. And then you lay in the machine, and all of a sudden they're finding spots and cracks and flaws and problems and this and that. And then the doctor says, man, you know, you got a problem inside of you. And I say, that darn MRI. It's all the MRI's fault. You see, the law is an MRI. Doc, tell you what, can I go back through that MRI and make it heal me? Listen, if the MRI is the problem, it's the one telling me I've got the cancer, so I want that MRI to be my ultimate answer. The law will tell you you're sick inside. It's called the cancer of sin. And then people run back to the law thinking, well, then it's going to heal me. You go back to the MRI. Can the MRI heal you? You know what it keeps doing? All right, okay, let's tell you what. I'll make another $1,800. Yeah, let's put you through the MRI again. And you just sit there, and you come out, and the doctor says, Alex, I got bad news for you. You know what? All of that disease, it's still inside of you. That MRI. I want to do it one more time. The doctor says, all right, another $1,800. Go ahead. And, you know, the law is no different. Don't blame the law. The law is like a ruler. The law is like an MRI. All it does is expose what you are, who you are, and it makes sin appear. You see, just because you look good on the outside, some of you, not all of you, just because you might live right on the outside, the law says, all right, let's see what's inside. And now you know how the motions of sins which were by the law. Don't blame the MRI. Don't blame the law. The law's doing its job. Guilty, 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 guilty. Why would you go back to the MRI to get healed? It can't. Why would you go to the law to be spiritually cleansed? It can't change you on the inside. There's a fundamental problem, sin. And the law's not a friend. The law will never aid you. The law will never help you. The law simply exposes, yeah, look at more cancer, more cancer, more cancer, more disease. The more you live under the law, the more you are exposed for what you really are. You never can achieve the holy righteousness of Almighty God. And remember, what do we do as sinners? We carnalize the holiness of God. Anybody who thinks I can achieve it, they think God is nothing more than a mere man. They carnalize his glory. They demean. When God says he demands righteousness, don't play. He demands absolute, unbroken perfection. Who has the guts to say you've done it? Chapter 8. Look at chapter 8, verse 3. For what the law could not do. What did we learn in Galatians chapter? Could the law give life? It cannot give you life any more than an MRI can give you life. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the what? How many of you were born in flesh? Whether it's physical, biological flesh, or it's the flesh called the old sin nature. Every one of us, could the law give you life? You know what we now know? Paul says, couldn't do it. Can't do it. Never will. Chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, verse 4. Chapter 10, verse 4. Man, wait till we get over here. For Christ is the end of the law for what? It's a person who brings it to an end. We can go on and on, but listen, Paul was antinomial. I'm not. I just believe what the verses say. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And again, it's a self-righteous, arrogant moralist who's all offended when you claim that we can only do it without it. Because it's the pride that says, you sissy Christians, you cheap believers, you know, cheap grace, cheap believism, all that kind of baloney. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and notice there verse 56. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the what? I thought the law stopped sin. I've yet to read one verse, specifically in Paul's epistles, where Paul ever says, hey, the law can help you stop it. What is Paul saying? It'll fuel it. It energizes it. It agitates it. It empowers it. And that's what the verse just said, right? The strength of sin is not the flesh. The strength of sin is what? The performance management system that demands unbroken perfection. What? Something doesn't make sense here. 2 Corinthians, well, tell you what, go to Galatians chapter 2. This is a great passage. Galatians chapter 2. And look at Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Galatians 2, verse 21. Verse 21 of Galatians chapter 2. I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. You know what Paul's saying here? Christ's death has no value. It has no merit. The propitiatory work that Paul's going to describe in elaborate detail in Romans chapter 3, it's all fiction. Christ died as a dead, stupid Jew. You see what the ramification, if righteousness come by the what, then what happened 2,000 years ago was a comedy. It really was some stupid Jew born of a bed-hopping woman who was put on that cross. Absolute rubbish. His death is no different than the death of any other human being in history. That's what Paul's saying. Listen, I'm not against the law. God is against law as a means of salvation and as a means of personal growth and development called sanctification. God's against it. Ephesians. Look at Galatians 5. I just want to read Galatians chapter 5 and look at verse 1 because James is going to say something, and I just want you to remember what Paul says here in Galatians 5 verse 1. Stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of... Now, Paul's talking about the law, by the way. Look there at verse 4. Christ has become of no effect unto you, whosoever you are justified by the law. Ye are fallen from grace. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 15. Ephesians 2, verse 15. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances. Who abolished it? God got rid of it. God abolished He abolished the law, by the way, when we compare this with Colossians. Go to Colossians. Look there at Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. And notice there verse 14. Colossians 2, verse 14. Let's read verse 13 just so we know what's happening. Verse 13. And you being dead in your sins. Think about that. I just heard about this poor, Chuck's son was at a basketball game, and in the middle of the basketball game, a 40-something-year-old guy falls dead on the court in front of his wife and children. And wow, isn't that just tragic? And please, I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but did anybody say, let's take that person and let's run him through the MRI? Can anything bring a dead person back to life? Look at verse 13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Notice verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. How come Paul doesn't say, oh, that law could give life to the dead sinner? Who's the only person that can give life to the dead sinner? Apart from the law. That's the argument here, because verse 14, when God blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. The law is not a friend. It's against you. The law is contrary to you. It's your enemy. The law is your enemy. God says, I want to be your friend, okay? I mean, we can go through, I mean, there's without a doubt. Go back to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. We need to have a proper dispensational understanding of the law and its purpose. And right now in Romans chapter 3, the emphasis that is being made, the doctrinal point that Paul is making is that that entire system of the law cannot make you a just person, a righteous person. So, stop going to the performance management system. There's nothing you can do to earn it. That's the point. You cannot earn it. Verse 21 now, Romans chapter 3, verse 21. But, now here we go, but now, there we go, very important dispensational label here or language. Verse 21, but now the righteousness of God, here we go, without the law is manifested. The same righteousness which condemns the sinner is the same righteousness which will vindicate the sinner. Isn't that wonderful? The same righteousness that God demands is the same righteousness that God provides. That's what Paul's getting at here. When he says, now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested. By the way, he's not saying that there is now a new kind of righteousness. Sometimes we're accused of, oh, okay, what you're saying is that since the law failed, then God, nervously scrambled to come up with another way, and now he resorts to grace. As though the righteousness under the law is different than the righteousness that God offers in grace. Wait a minute. It's the same righteousness of God, okay? The point that Paul's going to make here is, Paul is not dealing with a new type of righteousness. It's the same righteousness of Almighty God that he has always demanded. What Paul's arguing is, there's a new way of understanding it. There is a new way of making the righteousness of God known. And how is that righteousness now made known? Without the law. Paul's the first one. Go to chapter 1, verse 16. And Paul, by the way, said something already about the righteousness of God in chapter 1, verse 16. Chapter 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the good news of Jesus Christ, which, remember, what does 1 Corinthians say about the gospel of Christ? It's the preaching of the cross. And what do we know about the cross? For it is the power of God unto salvation. Not the law, because the law is weak. Now that's why Paul says that in Romans 8. The law is weak. Why? How? Through the flesh. What does a weak person need? Need strength, power. The power of God unto salvation cannot be by the law, because the law is ineffectual. The law fails. The law is impotent. The law is weak because of you. You're a sinner in the flesh. So the power, the energy, the capacities, and the built-in ability of Almighty God, the power of God unto salvation is what? It's the preaching of the cross. You see, that dead Jew wasn't a martyr. We're going to learn in Romans 3, he is God's propitiation. It's the Father who brought him to that cross. God says, that's the power unto salvation. My dead son, not your good works. Verse 16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Notice verse 17, for therein, the preaching of the cross, is the righteousness of God revealed. As far as Paul is concerned, when we want to argue the righteousness of God, who has it, who doesn't have it, how do you get it, where does he always take us? He takes us to our Christianity. Begins, guess where? Now, why do I want to make a point? You see, we have the so-called life of Christ. Our Christian identity never begins with the life of Jesus Christ and his incarnation. You know where our life begins? The death, burial, and resurrection. You know why that's critically important? Because there are some, there's a theology out there that is going to teach. We'll go back to Romans 3 here. I promise. They teach that Jesus Christ's life in living the law was vicarious. In other words, Christ's law-abiding ability has been done for us vicariously. What they're saying is because Jesus could live under the law perfectly, and we trust in him, he now gives to us the capacity to live our lives as perfectly under the law. Paul wouldn't. Wait a minute. Where does it begin? When he died. Our Christian life begins at the cross, not at the incarnation. And the reason I really want, because it is really the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. Because Jesus lived perfectly under the law, you can live perfectly under the law. Now, did we read enough verses where the law is a real problem? Why does God say, I got to get rid of it? Why does he say, I got to nail it to the cross? Why does, if God's intention is, well, now that you're saved, live under the law, why does he keep telling me it's a problem? And we want to understand, we have to have a right understanding. Verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed. Now notice, from faith to faith. Whoever said that before Paul? No one. There is something about the righteousness of God that is now being revealed. And it has to do with faith to faith. Nobody knew about this. That's why Paul says, but now, right now, dispensationally, there's some new revelation. The righteousness of God, by the God, listen, God, the righteousness of God is the same in eternity past as it was at the start of creation, as it will be in eternity, okay? The righteousness of God, it doesn't vacillate. He's immutable. He is who he is. And what do we learn about who he is in the book of Revelation? Three words, holy, holy, holy. In case we didn't get it the second time, holy. I mean, you got the point, right? The Godhead, Father, Son, holy, holy, holy. Never changes. The way we now understand how it works to our benefit is now made known. Moses ever run around saying, hey, don't worry about it, Israel. Faith to faith. No, Moses says, you don't abide, God's going to destroy you. Jesus Christ say, you teach against it, you're going to be the least. Paul's the one who says, it's gone. We don't need it. And then you're calling me a nut? Paul's the one who said it. Romans chapter 3, go back. Romans chapter 3. The same righteousness, it's still the righteousness of God, only we now know that it is achieved. We now know for the very first time that the righteous demands of God, it's achieved. How? By the grace of Almighty God through the redemption that is in His Son, Jesus Christ. Nobody knew anything about that prior to the Apostle Paul. Oh, but John 3:16, you know, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish. And then all of a sudden they interject all of this doctrine back to John 3:16. John 3:16 is not talking about the mechanism and the technique. You see what you have to be careful when you rightly divide the word. Don't read back into passages doctrine that is over in the book of Romans. Jesus never said anything about believe in my shed blood and the accomplishments of my crucifixion, my death, burial, and resurrection as the answer to your problem. Did Jesus ever say that? No. It's not there. Romans chapter 3, verse 20, therefore, by the, verse 21, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifest. That's the issue. It's the same righteousness. Only now we're going to learn something about it without the law. Look at verse 22. Even the righteousness of God. You see that? Verse 26, to declare, I say, at this time, His what? Righteousness. So it's a new way of understanding what this righteousness of God is. We're going to stop. Don't believe me. We're going to spend a little time here because this is our eternal life right here in a few verses, okay? When Paul talks about his righteousness in verse 26, what we're learning is that God's rightness in declaring a sinner righteous. We have to understand something about the righteousness of God. God cannot legally declare a sinner as righteous without violating his integrity unless he tells us about, number one, how he can do it without violating his integrity. Number two, how he can do it all the while maintaining the integrity of his righteousness. And then thirdly, what we're ultimately going to learn is that he's making it known by the only provision that could ever deal with sin at the same time, declare a sinner righteous. Who before Paul ever said anything about that? How can God be righteous and go to the sinner and say, I'm going to make you righteous? And by the way, I'm going to stop. We don't stand before God righteous. You ever hear people say that? I stand before God righteous. I stand as righteous. There's a difference. Let's close here. We're going to pick all of this up again next week. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. There is a lack of understanding when it comes to what God declares when He says, you're now my righteousness. We don't stand before Him acquitted. We don't just stand before Him forgiven. We don't just stand before Him released from the penalty and the consequences. We stand in His righteousness. We are as righteous as God. That's heresy. No, that's Bible doctrine. Now, look at 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21, and we're going to... So please, don't think that now I stand righteous. You are righteous. You are His righteousness. That is one powerful proclamation that God makes. Did you wake up this morning just saying, I'm righteous? Do you wake up every morning saying, I'm righteous? Well, according to this verse, verse 21 of 2 Corinthians 5, for He hath made Him... That's the Father who made His Son, Jesus Christ, to be sin for us. That's the doctrine of propitiation. Who knew no sin. Why? That we might stand before Him as righteous. That we might be made the what? Righteousness of God. God says, you better have the same measure and righteousness that I possess. That's what God makes us. 1 Corinthians, we read that Christ Jesus, He is my righteousness. We don't stand before Him as righteous. We are his righteousness. Isn't that powerful? Would you want to go back to the law that's always saying, boy, you screwed up over there. Boy, you had an angry thought over here. You see, that's what the law does. Or how about resting in the grace of Almighty God because of the ultimate eternal provision that was there at Calvary and where God says, you're now my righteousness. And what did I do to contribute to that? Grace can never be grace if there was 0.0001% of your participation. Go ahead. I mean, just 0.00001. If that's how much God demands from you, it cannot be great. Grace can only be grace if he does 100% of all the work. And God's telling us, I already did it for you. Hey, I'm going to shut up. I mean it. I'm going to shut up right now. Okay. No, but you know what? Wow. But you know, I did sin. Wait a minute. You know what we're going to find out? You know what God's righteousness is? No, you didn't. Wait a minute. But no, I sinned. No, you didn't. Now, this is going to get kind of interesting here. But wait a minute. God's going to say, no, you didn't. What do you mean I didn't? My son did on your behalf. He didn't commit the sin, but he was made sin. Now we're going to have to have an entirely new way of thinking about sin. And that's what Romans 6, 7, and 8 is going to do. We have to understand, we're dead. That past is gone. Stop living in the graveyard. But I did. No, you didn't. But you know, I'm really not righteous. Oh, yes, you are. You're God's righteous. Can you imagine the holy angels of Almighty God, when they see you as members of the body of Christ, you know what they see? The righteousness of God. You see why we're going to be higher, not higher in the sense that we're better. We were, as sons of Adam, lower than the angels. But you know what it means to be in Christ? When we possess his righteousness, those angels are flabbergasted. There's the righteousness of the Father. There's the righteousness of Jesus Christ. There's the righteousness of the Holy Spirit. And you know what they see? The righteousness of God. Where? In you, in me. The body. That's pretty high, isn't it? That's a high calling. Father, we do thank you for your love, your mercy, your grace that has made the provision for us. Lord, as we progress through the book of Romans, may we not only rejoice and be stirred because of what you've done for us, but Father, may we just take to heart this vitally important doctrine. And as we continually build upon this important foundation, may our Christian lives be stable, unmovable, and may we continue to grow upon that firm foundation. We just thank you for your word, the power of it as it effectually works in us as we believe it to be the truth. May we just shut up and believe what you got to say to us. And we just pray in Christ's name. Amen.